do? Do you want to see where we're at? That's the screen you have to be on.
Okay, so they stand in front of the candles on the left.
Yeah.
Okay. And thank you for your patience tonight. Of course, it's going to be Christmas Eve when our system is going to get a little grumpy with us. But we get to worship nonetheless. There are people who are celebrating Christmas in South America, laying out a blanket on the ground with communion elements and a Bible. Folks who are worshiping in a mud hut, we can worship wherever we need to, and we celebrate nonetheless. To get our worship started, we're going to be singing just one verse of each of our hymns, since we're not a real big group. So we'll sing verse 1 of O Come All Ye Faithful.
Thank you. Our first reading is from the prophet Isaiah, the 9th chapter. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. The joy they rejoice before you, as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with divided plunder. For the yoke of their burden, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the trampling warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulder, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here is the reading. Our second lesson comes from the letter to Titus, chapter 2. Here the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the present age to live lives that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He it is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify for himself a people of his own, who are zealous for good deeds. Here ends the reading. We'll now sing the first verse of Away in the Manger, hymn 67. And this was the first registration that was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in the manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You'll find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." And the angels had left them and gone into heaven. The shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as had been told them. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Yeah, the sermon starter worked a little bit better at the nursing home and at Country View. But for those of you who are really old like I am, you remember all the awesome things that our newspapers used to print about who had coffee with who served the coffee, what desserts were sold, were served, and who went home happy. I don't know if you remember those days, but that was big news when I was growing up. And then yesterday I turned on the evening news on CBS, and you know what? I didn't know who had coffee with who. It was very disturbing. You ever notice that? None of the national news services worried about who went over to have coffee with who here in Walnut Grove. I don't know why. I think it should be important news, don't you? But no, it's actually rather ordinary news, isn't it? An ordinary time when we go and spend time with those that we love, with friends and family, share coffee and cookies. It's an ordinary time. It's nothing spectacular, just ordinary. Think about how ordinary we are in this area. We have stay-at-home parents who care for their children. We have teachers who go and teach their children in ordinary ways. We have farmers and dairy who take care of their animals and their crops in ordinary ways. Nothing spectacular, well, except for the pageant. Happens here. You know, it's all ordinary. And then I read through our gospel reading and think about how ordinary this is. It starts off with Mary and Joseph needed to pay taxes. That's exciting, isn't it? Everybody loves paying taxes. And so he had to go and have a census. And he brought his betrothed, Mary, who was pregnant, along with him. And they got to Bethlehem. And they needed a baby. Or the baby was born, and they needed space for the baby. Now, for me, both our daughters were born in a hospital. But I know when I talk to people who are older than I am, it was not uncommon for babies to be born at home. To be born in the place that you lived. And usually you'd want to find a place that was a little bit secluded for some privacy. And that's where we find Mary. Mary was giving birth out with the animals. A place that wasn't surrounded by other people. A place of privacy. And believe it or not, a place of a little bit warmth because of the body heat from the animals. Jesus was born in an ordinary place. Placed in an ordinary manger and wrapped in ordinary cloths. God comes to us in ordinary ways. It doesn't have to be spectacular. Think about all the ways that God comes to us. Emmanuel. Then we see the shepherds out in the field watching their sheep. Evening time, they're probably gathered around a fire, trying to relax, doing ordinary things. Not much different than we would see farmers around here, planting their crops, harvesting their crops, driving the road to see how the crops were doing. I'm doubting many did that yesterday. But they were doing the ordinary thing. And suddenly the angels appeared in their presence and declared to them good news for all people, that the Messiah, the Son of God, was born in Bethlehem. And their reaction was to go and find out and see what this was taking place. And they went and told Mary and all who were there. And Mary pondered these wonderful things in her heart. Think about the ordinariness of this. A baby, some shepherds, taxes. And this is where I think God comes to us most clearly in our lives. Is in the ordinary things. The stories that are shared between family and friends during times of struggle, the words of comfort, the hugs, the presence of those who love us to give us strength. During joyous times, having those who are near us come together and celebrate with us. In the ordinary places, the greetings, the sharing of coffee, the sharing of cookies, the ordinary things that we see God's love expressed to us in ordinary ways. That's the miracle of Christmas. We have God, the one who created us and the whole universe, come to us as a child who is ordinary. who needs to be rocked back and forth, who needs to be fed and changed and cared for, in order to say that I am with you. I love you. So as we celebrate these ordinary things, we remember that that is where I think we can find God most clearly, is in the ordinary times. The times we do gather, and to put in the paper who had coffee, who had cookies, and who had a joyous time. Because our God is the one gathering with us. Our God is the one walking with us. I think that's the miraculous thing. We light these candles tonight. Soon we'll let you light candles. And I remember the text we have when we celebrate baptisms. In this Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, "Let your light so shine before others that they see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." God's light now shines in us and out into the world, out into a very dark world. So in the ordinary things we do, the way we express love for family and friends, we bring God, we bring Christ into their presence. Because God is Emmanuel, with us, now and forever. That's what we celebrate on this Christmas. That God is here, now with us. Not just in the miraculous, huge, awesome things, but in the ordinary. The ordinariness of a child being born and laying to rest, wrapped in cloth. Amen. Now we'll continue with the hymn number 71. Angels We Have Heard on High. We'll do the first verse again.
Thanksgiving for Christ coming into the world, we pray for the church, the life of the earth, and the whole human family. Mighty God, your infinite love is born to us this night. With choirs of angels, the church proclaims the good news. Send us out as messengers of the hope that has come to all people. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You are pleased to dwell with your creatures, and the whole earth sings for joy. Renew the splendor of creation from the smallest cell to the widest galaxies. Guide us to be wise stewards of your gifts for the sake of generations to come. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your authority is over the nations. Break the rod of oppression in every land and free all people from fear. Bring peace where there is war, compassion where there is suffering, and healing where there is disease. We pray, Lord, especially for the land of Ukraine and all other places where there's violence. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
You cherish those who are most vulnerable. Protect infants and children, and bless those who care for them. Watch over women giving birth, attend the dying, and relieve any who are in pain. Shelter refugee families and those who have no home. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your loving kindness embraces everyone in need. Help any for whom this season is lonely or joyless. Comfort those among us or known to us who are experiencing distress of body or mind, missing loved ones, or grieving. We pray especially for the families of Paul Johnson and Doug Mithune, God of Grace. You welcome those who have died into the joyous light of glory. We give thanks for the saints of every time and place who have praised you with lives of faith and humility. Inspire us by their example to love you by serving others. God of Grace. Pondering the mystery of eternal love made flesh in Christ Jesus, we commend all for whom we pray to the mercy of God. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace. We will receive the offering. Forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Let us pray as our Savior taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord sets his table and invites you to come.
I think we'll do continuous.
Thank you.
According to St. John, the first chapter. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him. And without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being with him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came to witness and testify to the light, that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he comes to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave the power to become the children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory is of the Father's only Son, full of truth and grace. And I will continue with verse 1 of Silent.
Thank you.
this night of light. May the God of the angels who heralded Christ's birth bring joy to your hearts this day and always.
Amen.
May the God of love, who gave his only Son to be born for you, fill your life with love and peace. May Emmanuel, God with us, be with you in all your doings and all your celebrations, until he brings you to his eternal kingdom.
Amen.
And may Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen.
I invite you to blow out your candles, and we shall sing Joy to the World, the first verse.
Thank you.